and welcome to Excel Tips. My name is Neale Blackwood, CPA, and in this episode, we're going to look at some formula and function tips to help you create your formulas and functions. A word on terminology. Formulas and functions get used interchangeably. Now, that's not entirely accurate because you can have a formula without a function. So, for example, there's a formula. Anything that starts with the equal sign in Excel is a formula. So there's an example of a formula, but that doesn't have a function. So a function is something like the sum function, where we might go equals sum and select a range. That's the sum function. It adds up things and it requires a range to add them up. We'll come back to functions in a little bit more depth in a minute. But basically, a function is a formula, but you can have a formula without a function. So functions, if you like, are a subset of formulas. Okay, now speaking of formulas, the formula bar, that's this little section of the screen up here. I use that to do all my creation and editing of formulas. There is a setting to edit in the cell, but I don't use it. I use the formula bar to do my formulas. The reason is when you're editing in a cell, you are sort of limited by what's around you in the cell. Whereas in the formula bar, you have a lot of room and it's much easier to work with than working in the cell. So I've made the formula bar a bit bigger. It's using a larger font. So I do a lot of training and screen shares, so it's much easier to use a larger formula bar, so it's you can see the formulas better. Now, starting formulas. Most times people tell you have to start with the equal sign. Well, that's not entirely true, because what you can do is you can start with the plus sign. Now, the reason I do that is because I use the numeric keypad, which is on the far right of a full-size keyboard, and there's a nice big plus sign there, so it's really easy to hit that. And you can start your formulas with the plus, and then you can create a formula. Now, something that's changed a bit recently is if you're typing in a number with that plus sign, Excel will remove the plus sign for you. Now, that didn't happen in the old days. It used to remain there, but now Excel will remove that plus sign. So when I hit enter, and if we go back to it, you'll see that that plus sign isn't there anymore. It does leave it there for things like functions, but for numbers, it removes that plus sign. And you'll notice that Excel's put the equal sign there for you, so that's the advantage. You can start with the plus sign, and then Excel will insert the equal sign for you when you hit enter. So that's what I tend to do. It's quicker. The equal sign is sort of tucked away in the middle of the keyboard, so I find it's much easier to use that large plus sign. Also, I do use a full-size keyboard. So if I'm on my laptop, I tend to also take the keyboard with me so that I can use that if I'm doing any sort of work. Okay, so let's talk about functions and how we can enter the functions. Let's say we want to use the VLOOKUP function. So I'll delete these. So let's say I want to look up a code. There we go. To look it up, I can use VLOOKUP. I can also use XLOOKUP. We'll use an example of that in a minute. So if you type in plus and then V, you'll notice that there's quite a few different functions that start with V, and they're all listed there. If you type in L, that limits the functions that are there, and notice that VLOOKUP is highlighted. So when that's highlighted, you can hit the tab key. And what that does is that puts the whole word in for you, and that opening bracket or parentheses. Now, the correct term is parentheses, but I'm going to use the term brackets because it's much easier to say. And so we can build the VLOOKUP function. So we can say we want to look up D2 in the range A2 to B8. We want to extract the second column and we want an exact match. So that's a VLOOKUP function that's going to return, in this case, the weight for ABC124, which is 0.99. When you're creating your formulas, if you start typing And I'll do the sumif s. I'm not going to create it, but when you type in the su, there's lots of functions that start with that. And as you type more and more, it reduces that list. Now, I don't use the sumif function anymore. I use sumif s. So if I use my down arrow, then that will select the sumif s, and then I can hit my tab. So you can use a combination of either the keyboard. You can also use the mouse. So you can use the mouse to double click on a function. And again, it puts the function name in there and the opening bracket, which saves you typing. By the way, that list will also include things like table names if you're using formatted tables, and also range names if you're using range names. Now, function arguments. Let's use XLOOKUP as an example here. So equals XL. If you type in XL, then you can hit the tab and you'll get XLOOKUP. Underneath the function there is a listing of all of what are called the arguments. Now, arguments are the parts of the function, if you like. They're separated by commas, and underneath it shows you the argument that you're up to. So for example, at the moment, the bold lookup value is what it's expecting. So I can click on D2, and when I hit the comma, you'll notice that it then moves across, in this case, to the lookup array. So I need to tell it what range to look in for ABC124, which is this range here, comma, and then the return array. So what range do you want to extract, basically, which is B2 down to B8, comma. You can define, in this case, if not found. So notice that if not found has square brackets around it. What that means is it's optional, so you don't have to put it in. I am going to put it in. I'm just going to put a zero there. There's also a thing called match mode and then search mode. I have covered XLOOKUP in a fairly detailed article, so just do a search on the In the Black website and you'll find that. So I won't go into what they do, but I can close the bracket there. Okay, so I can hit enter, and that's going to return the same. VLOOKUP and XLOOKUP are similar. XLOOKUP is the new lookup function. It's probably the best one to use now. VLOOKUP is, to some extent, redundant. Now, when you're creating a formula, in many cases, you need to use the dollar signs. Now, the dollar signs will fix the cell references. So let's create that XLOOKUP again. Now, I want to look up D2, comma. Now, if we wanted to copy this formula around the place, we would need to fix the ranges. So with A2 to A8, if I want to fix that and make it at what's called an absolute reference or a fixed reference, you can press the F4 function key. And that puts the dollar signs on all of the references. Then I can go comma and let's say the weight. And again, I can press my F4 and then comma zero and close the bracket. So what that does is if I copy this formula around the sheet, those range references there will not change. They are fixed or absolute. They just don't change as you copy them around. The D2 reference is what's called a relative reference, and that will change relative to where you copy it from and paste it to. That's a heads up on the dollar signs. The dollar signs fix whatever it's in front of. So for example, if I use the D2 example here, if I press the F4 key once, I get both dollar signs. If I press it again, I'll get the dollar sign on the row number. Press it again, I get the dollar sign on the column. So that fixes whatever it's in front of. So in this case, the D wouldn't change if I copied it across. And if you press it again, it goes back to the relative reference. So that sequence, so press it once, twice, three times, four times, that sequence is set, so it always keeps that sequence. So you get used to how many times you need to press the F4 key. Now, when you're editing a formula, the F4 key works a little bit differently. So this is a formula that was already there. Now, if I press the F4 key here, it's only going to change the A8 reference. Okay, so when you're creating the formula, it's going to put more dollar signs in, basically. So when I was creating the formula, it put the dollar signs on both references. When you're editing, it only works on the reference that it's next to. So if I click there and press F4, you'll notice that it puts it there. So let's get rid of those, and then I'll show you. If you did want to do the whole range, you do need to select the range and then press F4. There we go. So you can still do it, but you've got to select the range first. So when you're editing a formula, the F4 key works a little bit differently to when you're creating the formula. So just a heads up on that. Now, calculation sequence. Let's have a look at that. When you're creating a formula, so let's create a formula. So here we go. We'll test out your maths. I'm going to create a formula here, plus 5 plus 10 times 3. So what would that formula equal? So plus 5, so that's 15 times 3. Is it going to equal 45? Let's find out. So when we hit enter, you'll see it doesn't equal 45, it equals 35. And the reason is Excel's calculation sequence, which is the maths calculation sequence. You might have learned it at school as BIMDAS, so brackets, indices, multiplication, division, addition, and subtraction. So that's the sequence of the calculation. So to take this through, it does the multiplication first. So the asterisk is the multiplication symbol. Then it adds the 5 to it. So that's the sequence that it's done. Now, if you want to override that, what you do is you put the brackets around the part that you want calculated first. So if you put the brackets around the 5 plus 10, that's going to be calculated first, and then that will be multiplied by 3. So this one will give you 45. So you can use the brackets, parentheses, to override the calculation sequence and basically control it a little bit better. The brackets and the quotation marks need a pair of them. So, and that's something that Excel does use color coding. So let's do a common if function here. So if this cell is blank, comma, then you might display blank. Otherwise, you're going to do that. Now, when I put the, notice the coloring here now of the brackets. The XLOOKUP's brackets have changed to red, and when I press the last bracket, it goes black. The last bracket should always be black. It does use a hierarchy of colors, so the next level down is red, and I think the next level after that is green, and then it goes purple and some other ones. So just a heads up on colors, but you do need to make sure that you match your brackets. So the color coding is quite useful. If I delete both, and if I press the bracket, it will go bold for a fraction of a second, and so does the first one. And if again I do that, it goes, the black one, I don't know that it does because it's always black and it's always at the end. So if your last bracket isn't black, then you've probably missed a bracket. If you've got two black brackets at the end, it means, if I do another one, it means you've got too many. So the colors are quite useful, and they do help you get your brackets matched, and so you can check that you've got them lined up correctly. Okay, so that one does a little bit differently. So if this cell is blank, it displays a blank cell. If I put a wrong code here, then that's when I get that none. So this is basically saying I can't find it, so I'm going to display the word none. That's why XLOOKUP is a little bit more flexible than VLOOKUP. It's got a built-in error handler, if you like. Okay, so I've covered a whole lot of tips and tricks associated with formulas and functions. I hope you found that useful. Thanks for watching.